Chances are, if you see a modern layout on the web, it's styled using classes. We use a class to set styling once, and we apply that class to everything we want. The result, of course, we have consistency in styling, but even more importantly, we have continuity. That is, if we make a change on the class, every other element with that class gets the update too. We'll start here. We'll start with creating and applying classes. We'll talk about editing classes, that's changing those styles. We'll do removing and duplicating classes. Then we'll end by covering two actual superpowers on the web, combo classes and global classes. So, to create a class, select a thing, click into the selector field, and name your class. When you hit return, you've created a class. Why is this important? It's not, because we haven't actually done anything with it yet. And here's why that's important to demonstrate. If we change something super basic, let's change the background color to make it a bit darker. The moment we've done that on the class we just created, the label turns blue. That means on this class, this background color property has been set. So check this out. Let's just grab another button. By default, elements don't come with classes applied. Then instead of clicking in to name a class, let's just start typing out the old one we did before. When we select it, darker background color. That's how classes work. You can use them on different elements, and when you add or change style properties, every element that uses that class is affected. That's creating and applying classes. What about editing classes? Well, let's go further. Let's apply that same class to other buttons here. And if we copy and paste our button, just make a copy, the class is brought along with that element. It still has that class applied. And to edit this class, do we have to go back to the original button? No, because like we did before, we can just select any element that has our main button class applied. Then we edit the styling. Again, the key with classes is this: you're not editing styles on the element. You're editing the class that's been applied to all these elements. And if we want to rename, we're talking about renaming a class, we can click into the thing, rename, hit return. That's editing classes. Next, let's remove a class. Here's a paragraph, let's select it, and of course, apply the main button class. Terrible. So let's click the drop-down thing next to the name of the class, remove, class removed. Let's do it again. Select the section, go over, apply the main button class. Again, terrible. But this time let's click to the right of the class label. Blinking cursor, we'll get to that in a second. Delete, or backspace depending on your keyboard. Class removed. Stanford University, log in as an administrator, fall semester, delete, confirm. That's removing classes. What about duplicating? Well, this is a two-parter because most of the time, duplicating can be better served by other stuff, but let's suppose we have a div block here, a box that holds some other stuff inside. This is sort of a card design. If we open our navigator, we see there's an image, a heading, and a paragraph. Or if we're feeling adventurous, we can always look on the canvas and see the same exact thing. The key here is that the div block is styled, our card is styled, using a class. The class is called basic card, and it's been applied to all three of these things. The third one, the card on the right, if we change any styling on it, it affects the other two as well. We know that's how classes work. But what if we want the third one to be different? Again, this is going to be one way to do it. With our third card selected, let's go into the down arrow drop-down thing and duplicate. And we'll name this other card design. Of course, you can name yours whatever makes sense. But when we hit return, we've now created this new class, which brought over all the stuff from the original one. From afar, it looks the same, and that's, of course, because it's stylistically identical. But we can change any properties and reuse this new class anywhere else. But here's the sad part. Because it's fully duplicated, it is in no way whatsoever associated with the original class. Sometimes that's what we want. That's why we're covering class duplication. But other times we want something different. Enter 301 redirects, except no, that's a separate lesson. Enter combo classes, just like duplicating a class, but actually not at all. That's because a combo class still references the original class, the base class. All these buttons on this page, they use the same class, main button. But here's an example of when that doesn't work so well. This section is darker, so there's not too much contrast between the button and the background. So what do? We leave the class as is. We keep the base class, the class we already added, we keep it. And what we can do with that button selected is click to the right of the class label and type to create a combo class. Lighter. Press return, and here's the magic. This combo class is built upon the base class, and We can prove it by clicking the amber color label. Amber on a label means it's grabbing styles from somewhere else, and it shows that the color is being brought in from the main button class. So what if we change it? Well, because it's a combo class, because it's more specific than our original base class, that change didn't affect our main button class. Those stay the same. We can change the font color too. We're making changes only on buttons that have main button and lighter applied. But here's where this is different from duplicating. If we go back to our base class and change the padding, really if we style almost anything on the base class, the combo class is affected too. That's because all the combo class does is override. It adds more specific styles, but it builds on our base class. So when we're styling that new combo class, it's helpful to look at our indicators. Where are the styles coming from? And if we want to override a style, we make that change. Now, combo classes work just like classes in that you can take a brand new element. Here's a blank button we're just dragging in, and we can add our combo class by adding the base class, hit return, then clicking in one more time to add our combo class. Hit return again. We've now applied the combo class. Now, this can be a lot. And if you're already super familiar with HTML and CSS, great, that'll speed things up. But if you're new to all of this, if you're new to classes and combo classes and references to hacking a world-class university, that's okay. We're going to recap all of this, and we have highly specific practical examples to really reinforce these concepts throughout Webflow University, including tags, which are like superclasses, but completely different. One note we'll make here is that the difference between duplicating a class and just using a combo class is that duplicating is something that ends the relationship with the original class. When a class is duplicated, it brings all the styles from the original class, but that's it. The relationship stops there. These are now two totally different classes that don't talk to each other at all. With a combo class, you're still able to bring in styles from that base class. It's a commensalistic relationship where styles are passed from the base class one way, and those styles can affect the combo class. But all you're really doing is building on top of the original. And so while you can override styles on the combo class, those changes only go one way. If you go back and change something on the base class, that's going to update in the combo class as well, even though we can override that style in the combo class. Now, we'll summarize, we'll recap all of this as we move forward, but before we do, let's complete our goals and talk about the concept of global classes. A global class is great when you're trying to apply specific styles to a wide range of elements. First, we'll demonstrate this, then we'll clarify exactly what's going on behind the scenes. And we'll start with Rob Lowe. This is not Rob Lowe. It's a div block with nothing applied to it. No classes. It hasn't been styled in any way. But we're going to create a normal class on it. We'll type Rob Lowe and hit return. And here's where it gets intense. Let's set the background. We'll add a background image to the Rob Lowe class, and we'll choose from our many images of Rob Lowe. And just like that, we applied a Rob Lowe background image to our Rob Lowe class. So far, it's just like styling any other class. But here's how it's used globally. Suppose we have all these different kinds of elements, a div block that's used as a card, our navigation, a navbar, these buttons here. In fact, if we click into any of these elements, they already have classes, different classes. Even if we click this heading here, let's name this example heading. And when we do, let's make a styling change here too. Let's change the font size. And of course, we can also mess with the line height. So each of these has a base class, a different base class. And the point is this, what we're about to do, using our Rob Lowe class globally, a global class, will apply those specific properties, specific styles, to something that already has a class. And it works like this. We'll click in to the right and start typing Rob Lowe. When we add it, notice how it's listed as a global class. When we add it, that background image and all its styling is now applied to the card. But here's why this is a big deal. Suppose we do the same thing here on the navbar. With the navbar selected, we can add our Rob Lowe class globally. Same thing with these buttons. But notice here how we have to add it to each of them. Adding a global class is done element by element. It doesn't go over and mess with other things that happen to have our button class applied. So we have to apply global classes to each instance of an element we want showing Rob Lowe. And that heading, we can do the same thing here. We can add Rob Lowe to the heading. And if we go back to the original div block, with just our Rob Lowe class applied, we can go in and tweak that background image. Maybe we want it not only to cover, but we want Rob Lowe's eyes perfectly positioned. Notice how it's updating on all different kinds of elements. And that's the big advantage here. If we added Rob Lowe as a background to all these different classes, if we went in and set the background image and cover, position, if we did that on all these classes, we'd develop significant wrist injuries and spend even more time if we wanted to make a change. So let's take a look at how this works technically. The global class, Rob Lowe, has styling properties applied to it. And by adding that on top of another class, we're able to apply the styling properties that come from the global class to other classes. And that really sets us up with an existential dilemma. How do we balance the fact that we can use combo classes or global classes at any time? And also, what's the meaning of life? We'll cover all of it, but the best way to do that is breaking it down into three: base classes, combo classes, and global classes. We already know base classes. It's just the class we create for basically all styling. It's a plain base class like button. A combo class is built on top of a base class. In other words, it lets us combine the base class with some more specific styling, like a dark version of the button, or a green one, or one that's larger, pink, and upside down. But a global class, this is a separate thing entirely. A global class is created on its own. And you can add whatever style properties you want, like a background image of Rob Lowe. And you can append a global class. You can add it to really anything you want. A base class, like a styled button, a combo class, like the dark button, it doesn't matter. The only thing that matters with global classes is this. They'll bring their styling to any element with any class or combo class applied, as long as a more specific property on those classes is not already applied. Put more clearly, if we have a class named Zoe Saldana and a background is already set on that class, adding the global class of Rob Lowe won't do a single thing. And that's because global classes will only apply styles that aren't already set. We can click the label and see that the background image is being set on the Zoe Saldana class. And a really practical way to think about this is, say we're starting to build a massive marketing site and we want an assortment of elements to all have a specific and consistent drop shadow. This card, this button, this image. Let's create a new class. A lot of times, to create something we're using as a global class, it makes sense to just use a temporary element, like a div block, and we'll add a name, Perfect Shadow. So we've created this class. This will be our global class. And we can shadow it very briefly right now. In fact, we're not going to put much care into this on purpose to prove a point, because we'll come back to it. And all we have to do is add this as a global class to that other stuff. We can add it to the card as a global class. We can add it to the button as a global class. That'll add the shadow there too. We can even add the perfect shadow to this image, even though it already has a combo class applied. We can even add global classes on top of combo classes. And now they all have the same shadow. And if we want to change the styling on our global class, we'll just select that sample div block from before. Again, we're just using this as a temporary thing so we can style the perfect shadow class. And when we do, we're able to perfect the shadow. All properties we're changing here are affecting the box shadow on all of these different kinds of elements. Now, does that mean we should use global classes all the time? Does it mean everything's a complicated mess of base classes and combo classes and global classes and master classes? Probably not so much. They're a tool we can use if we plan on making global changes that affect a bunch of elements in a similar way. In most cases, using base classes on commonly styled elements, this is a pretty good deal. Using combo classes on some of those, also a pretty good deal. And in the event that we want to apply a specific type of styling, some properties we want applied to classes of all kinds, we can use global classes. But that's the basic approach to styling for the modern web. We can create classes and apply them wherever we want to keep styling unified and organized. We can edit styles on those classes, which will affect all elements with that class applied. We can remove classes, we can duplicate classes if we want a starting point for a new kind of styling. We can use combo classes to make more specific versions or variants, like dark modes with lighter text, and we can always create global classes. When it's called for, we can apply a global class to pass specific styling to classes of different types. Now, if it seems like a lot, that's because it is. Classes and tags, which we cover in a separate lesson, these are powerful tools, and with them, you can style pretty much anything out there. Remember, most of the internet is built using classes. And because we don't have to style everything one by one, we can use classes to build almost any design we can dream up.